Film genre. What is film genre? Genre refers to the method based on similarities in the narrative elements from which films are constructed. Most theories of film genre are borrowed from literary genre. Screw this! Genre basically categorizes a film into a certain category. For example, this is a horror. This is an action. And this, well, I don't really know what that is. For this video, I'm mainly going to be focusing on the comedy genre. So films like these! I'm Thomas Ashwell, and welcome to my video on the comedy genre. So what is comedy? Comedy is a genre of film and television that primarily uses humor as a driving force. The aim of a comedy is to draw out laughter from the audience through entertaining stories and characters. Although the comedy film may take on some serious material, most have a happy ending. Comedy has a tendency to become a hybrid subgenre because humor can be incorporated into many other genres. An example of this is a movie directed by Edgar Wright, Shaun of the Dead. Shaun of the Dead takes the zombie genre and makes it hilarious by including various comedic elements into your typical zombie apocalypse story. Take this scene for example. As Shaun walks to and from the store, he is completely oblivious to the flesh-eating zombies around him. He even mistakes one of them for a beggar asking for money.
So I haven't got any change.
This is entertaining to audiences, as zombie movies are usually scary and have viewers on the edge of their seats. Shaun of the Dead takes that idea and incorporates a bit of realism, the idea that some people would be so stupid as to not notice an apocalypse happening right in front of them.
Hey Shaun, that's a zombie, and so is that. Those are zombies, Shaun. You should probably get running now.
Now you may be thinking to yourself, well, it's not that bad, that's just a couple of zombies. Every viewer is different, and many people in the audience will question the film and react to it in different ways. Not everyone will just blindly accept the message. Active spectators don't just consume what they're told to watch by the marketing aimed at them, but instead choose different films to watch for different reasons. The passive spectator theory, on the other hand, suggests we are all the same, and our intelligence, life experience, and everything else that makes us individuals does not affect our reception of the film. This ties in with a little thing called fandom, the community that surrounds a TV show, movie, book, etc. For example, on the 23rd of November 2013, the 50th anniversary special of Doctor Who was broadcast on BBC One and in select cinemas around the globe. Most people will have saved themselves money and watched it at home. However, fans of Doctor Who, Whovians, myself included, yeah, that's me, paid money to see the Day of the Doctor on the big screen, all because they are huge fans of the show. Stuart Hall looked at the role of audience positioning in the interpretation of mass media text by different social groups. Hall came up with a model suggesting three ways in which we may read a media text: the dominant, negotiated, and oppositional readings. The dominant reading is where the viewer fully accepts what the author intended them to. The negotiated reading is where the viewer partially agrees with what they have seen, but changes certain aspects to suit themselves. And the oppositional reading is where the viewer is fully opposed to what they have seen, and completely object it. Films that are seen as controversial sometimes cause people to have an oppositional reading. For example, Monty Python's Life of Brian is a story of Brian Cohen, a young Jewish man who is born on the same day as, and next door to, Jesus Christ, and is subsequently mistaken for the Messiah. The film contains religious themes that were controversial at the time of its release, drawing accusations of blasphemy and protests from some religious groups. 39 local authorities in the UK either imposed an outright ban or imposed an 18-year certificate, effectively preventing the film from being shown. Some countries, including Ireland and Norway, banned its showing, with a few of these bans lasting decades. The filmmakers used such notoriety to benefit their own marketing campaign, with posters stating, "So funny it was banned in Norway." Hey, listen now, I know this is a movie and everything, but I don't want y'all going making fun of our Lord Jesus Christ and all that. It's blasphemous. I don't like it. Next up is intertextuality is the shaping of a text meaning by another text, or using one text within another. For example, the use of a fairy tale within a music video. Gwen Stefani uses the narrative features of Rapunzel in a music video for The Sweet Escape. This movie is a great example of a movie that uses intertextuality.
I don't own a copy of the movie.
Epic Movie is a 2007 American parody film. It is a spoof of the epic style of films, hence the name. The film mostly references The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, the Harry Potter films, and Tim Burton's version of Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. Throughout the film, characters from multiple popular movies make appearances, including Captain Jack Sparrow, Superman, The White Witch, Harry Potter, Ron and Hermione, Willy Wonka, the X-Men, Borat, and even the remote from Click. Intertextuality allows for cross-promotion between different media texts, and could encourage audiences to go watch something that they wouldn't have normally thought of seeing. Epic Movie is a good example of this, just because of the large amount of movies it incorporates. The dawn of social media saw huge changes in the way movies are accepted and promoted. Different methods of advertising and marketing have allowed people to gain insight on a movie or TV show before they even decide if they want to watch it or not. Trailers and promotional posters are the most common sources of information about movies and are created for most, if not all, modern films. Something that a few movies have done is created interactive trailers. An example of this is Scott Pilgrim vs. the World. Before the Scott Pilgrim movie was released, Edgar Wright released an interactive version of the first trailer that allowed viewers to click on different parts of the video to gain information on different characters and locations. It's a pretty interesting concept, however mostly only for those that are deeply interested in the movie and the world that Edgar Wright has created. Sadly, the interactive trailer doesn't seem to work anymore on any of the sites that I visited. It's possible that it was only active before the movie's release. The advancement of technology has seen the creation of Netflix. For $5.99 a month, people can watch selected movies and TV shows online whenever they want. Along with increasing prices, this has seen a significant decrease in cinema viewings, as Netflix is much cheaper and more efficient for people.
Well, that's it. That's my video on the comedy genre, and on film genre in general. Blah!